will be just as interesting as we have our Dr. Naseem, the associate professor, SR Dr. Naseem Ameer Ali with us here today. He will be conducting 5-day webinar for us. His focus is on understanding principles of construction contract using a plain language contract. Today's session is supported by CIDB Malaysia, RISM, CADE, and Marseille University. Dr. Naseem, over to you.
Thank you, Cindy. Right, good morning, those in the UK and that part of the world, those who are in the Middle East, sort of late morning. In Malaysia, it's at 3 o'clock, and we're now at 7 o'clock in New Zealand. Welcome all. Thanks for this opportunity. Now, I'm going to just run through the PowerPoint slides. I'm just going to activate the screen as well. If you just give me 1 second. Right, okay. Just a bit of my background, first of all, for some of you who might not know me. I'm a quantity surveyor by background. That's really my core profession. Since then, after that, I qualified as a quant surveyor. I then moved on into project management and then moved on into doing a construction dispute resolution, construction contracts consultancy, and so on. And over the past nearly 10 years now, I've been gone into the academic line, and I'm lecturing at Massey University. I'm an associate professor there. And based in Auckland at the moment. So anyway, I see we've hit 300 people. I think quite a few more people are coming in, but we'll just carry on. Now, I just want to share with you what I'm going to do over the next 5 days. I'll give an overview, but let's start with today first. I want to thank, first of all, CIDB, Royal Institution of Surveyors Malaysia, the Chartered Association of Building Engineers, the Malaysian chapter, and of course, my university, Massey University, for supporting this. And of course, above all, the organizers L2, Lam Wai Lun and Leong Hong Kit, who have been organizing this series of 30-over sessions over the past 30 days. And this one is a little bit different in that it's a bit more in-depth. So we won't be just touching cursorily, but we'll be looking at a bit more in-depth. Now, before we start, because in countries like New Zealand, because we've got earthquakes and tornadoes and tsunamis and so on, let's get these health and safety house rules first. Now, each of you will be sitting wherever you are, so you need to know exactly which way you need to go if there's an emergency. So, for instance, in my case, that's the direction that I'll run straight out, down the stairs, and assemble down the shared driveway onto the road. So that's my emergency exit. So each of you knows where you are and how you're supposed to do this. Please bear that in mind. Of course, under the current circumstances with COVID-19, drills that we need to all know by now. The first rule, of course, is your face is sacred. Don't touch it. Don't touch your eyes, your nose, or your mouth. And if you don't touch your eyes, nose, or mouth, I think it should be okay. The second thing is, of course, keep your hands clean because you might be touching tables and so on. Within your house is okay because you know what you've done or have not done. And of course, the third thing is social distancing, as everyone else calls it, but I prefer to call it physical distancing. We're not socially distancing ourselves. I've been socializing even more during this lockdown with friends or WhatsApp and everything else. So let's call it physical distancing, not social distancing. Remember, this series of seminar or webinar Okay, thank you. We're unmuted. Now, let me just go back to sharing my screen again. Right. I was saying earlier that we must remember the drills, and here's another drill. Technology could drop, and all I have to do is communicate with my tech moderator through WhatsApp, and he'll be able to connect me back on. Right, let's move on. Now, the other is, of course, because there are a bunch of lawyers who have joined us, and I know there's quite a few lawyers who have joined us from all around the world, we have disclaimers. This is a classic traditional disclaimer. We can ignore that. That's not the way we're supposed to be writing disclaimer. Remember, this series focuses heavily on plain language, specifically plain legal language. Anyway, this is the traditional style of disclaimers, but I've noticed that in the PAM contract, which is the most commonly used construction contract in the private sector in Malaysia, the disclaimer is written relatively well. So we're starting to recognize good writing for a change. All parties must rely upon their own skill and judgment or upon those of the advisors. And let me just, okay. And upon those of the advisors when using this document, and PAM assumes no responsibility to any user or any third party. This is really nice. I like this. So we're starting to get there. I hope at this rate, the whole contract will be in plain language at some point. Now, this one here comes from a document called the Model Terms of Subcontract, published in 2007, which is a subcontract. Again, it's well written. The model terms are a set of general terms of contract intended to form part of a subcontract. By design, it's generic. By necessity, every subcontract must have its own specific provisions to suit the project. So this is, again, a nicely written plain language version. This one here comes from the footer of an email I received some time ago. This is how not to draft. And this one here is one which I use in all my emails. And it reads, please don't print this email unless necessary. This helps conserve the natural environment. This email and all attachments are meant for specific persons and may contain confidential information. If you're not the intended recipient, please delete it and don't share it with anyone. And again, we're trying to appeal to the emotions of people, the logic, and say, hey, look, your honesty is appreciated. That works well. You can't force people to delete it. Now, when the COVID lockdown started in New Zealand, this is the message that everyone in New Zealand who had a mobile phone received. And the message read, this message is for all of New Zealand. We depend on you. Where you stay tonight is where you must stay from now on. Simple as that. Now, that's plain language. And it worked very well. And I'll show you evidence of how well it's worked in New Zealand. Okay, now the next 5 days then, what is it that we're going to be looking at? Now, the whole process of construction projects, construction contracts, can be split into a few stages if you want. In day one, today, we'll be looking at forming the contract. So let's just use the word forming to remember. So we'll look at contract formation. What are the ingredients necessary and so on? And because, as I said earlier, we are focused on writing construction contracts in plain language. So there'll be a heavy emphasis on what are those drafting principle guidelines. We'll also test existing construction contracts from around the world to see whether they comply with plain language drafting guidelines. Of course, I'll be explaining what plain language is as well. Third is contract administration using the plain language pro-forma templates. Now, I may not do all the contract administration templates today because when we look at contract implementation or the ongoing process over the next 3 days, 4 days, I will be demonstrating using those contract administration pro-forma. So I might not cover all of them today, but I'll just demonstrate one or two. And the fourth thing that I will do, which again, over the next the 5 days, I'll be looking at how a particular plain language contract called the STCC-RSP 2015, which stands for Standard Terms of Construction Contract, Renovation and Small Projects, which is the first construction contract in the world to attain the Clear English Standard accreditation from the Plain Language Commission in the UK. So I'll be using that as an example. So that's day one. That's today. Now, tomorrow, I'll be looking at the performance relating to time, all the time obligations relating to, like, for instance, the commencement, starting the project, program. What's the implication of the program? Does it form part of the contract? Yes, no. And how can we draft contracts to make sure that it's nice and clear that it forms part of the contract or not, as the case may be? Progress. What are the typical obligations of a contractor or a subcontractor? Delays, suspension, adjustment of time. Now, don't we call it extension of time normally? Why have I used the word adjustment of time? I'll deal with that later. Completion, of course, non-completion, liquidated damage. Liquidated damage is fine. People know around the world. One thing I would say is this. Why haven't I used the word LAD, liquidated and ascertained damages, as what is commonly used or historically used to be used in the JCT contracts, in the Malaysian contracts that followed it, the Hong Kong contracts that followed it, and so on. I've just said liquidated damages. So we'll come to that as well. I'm just highlighting one or two things so that you come back tomorrow and we can talk more about it. And on day three, we'll be talking about money matters. Payment, bonds, performance bond, advance payment bonds, and on-demand bonds, and conditional bonds, and so on. Insurance, payment or non-payment, retentions, and final count. So there'll be the financial issues on day three. On day four, that's on Thursday, 7th of May, we'll be looking at the performance relating to quality issue, health, safety, environment, subcontracting, and termination. There's quite a bit to go through there on day four, but I will keep it within that, and we will finish on time. Now here, we'll be looking at issues relating to what happens if the quality is not to what the contract specifies and so on, defects, liability period, for instance, health, safety, environmental issues, subcontracting, domestic and nominated or named or domesticated nominated subcontractors or nominated domestic subcontractors, named subcontractors, and finally a termination on day four. Termination including trying to distinguish potentially between terminating the contract itself as opposed to terminating the contractor's employment, as is the case in many, many.
Yeah. Sorry, I think Dr. Naseem's line is not stable. So let's just give him a few seconds.
Okay, here we go. So all good? Yep, you can hear me. Yes. Okay, good. Now, so
it's 7:15.
I talked about day four. Let's look at what happens on day five, the final day. Now, on the final day, we'll be looking at storming. What is storming? Dispute resolution, basically. That's what storming is. And we'll briefly look at arbitration, adjudication, mediation, the differences. We'll be looking at some reforms that I'm going to suggest and norming post-2030. What is happening post-2030? The answer is we're going to have the smart contracts as a routine contract that we'll all be using around the world. Okay, now, just very quickly again, why is it that understanding construction contracts and knowledge in it is extremely important? Imagine this. You can do whatever you want. You can talk about a project which is delayed, a project which is not up to speed in terms of quality, or if there's disputes on payment, for instance, or someone is attempting to terminate you. Well, how do you decide who is right, who is wrong? Answer, you have to look at the contract. So it is critically important that there's a good level of understanding of construction contracts. Now, what is hindering the industry from embracing knowledge in construction contracts and improving the level of skills? People don't think construction contracts are sexy at all. They just don't like it. I've seen it many times. People don't think it's brilliant. But part of the reason why or the problem is this. When you have clauses like this, 159 words in one sentence, and can I please urge you not to attempt to read these sort of clauses in unless you're a good swimmer. Why? Because if you do try to read this in one breath, without prejudice in addition to any other rights and remedies of the employer, whether, look, you might endanger your health. So we don't want any incidents like that. So don't bother. This is another example. How many of us have come across contracts, construction contracts, which have got a plethora of cross-referencing and multiple cross-referencing? This is so common. Subject always to clause 42, and you go to 42, you come back, no, subject to 22, and you come to 22, you've forgotten. So these things hinder people from reading the contract. The contract that I'm going to use as an illustration over the next few days has got zero multiple cross-referencing. It's only got referencing to the appendices, and that's it. Okay. Anyway, let's start. Before we even look at the details of the contract terms, just a word of warning. Contracts don't have to be in writing. Contracts don't have to be signed. Contracts don't have to be signed, sealed, and delivered. There are some exceptions, but generally, contracts don't have to be written, don't have to be signed, don't have to be signed, sealed, delivered, or under seal, or executed as a deed. They don't have to. Many contracts every day around the world are entered into orally. You go and sit in a dentist's chair, it's a contract. You go to the supermarket and buy, it's a contract. But you might not have any written contract. You might not have even spoken a word. You can even have contracts through conduct. You don't even need the contract to be orally entered into. So just bear that in mind. I'm just highlighting a few terminology here. I put verbal in inverted commas. Don't use the word verbal. If you mean oral, use oral. If you mean written, use written. Don't use verbal. Why? Because verbal could mean written or oral. That's according to some definitions in dictionary. You can look it up and you'll see that verbal can be oral or written. So avoid it. We don't want any ambiguities. We don't want unnecessary disputes arising out of terminology. So you have oral contracts, you have written contracts, end of story. And if you look at the Construction Contracts Act in New Zealand, for instance, it says oral contracts, or partly written, partly oral. They don't use the word verbal. Well-written Act of Parliament. Now, so to form a contract, what are the ingredients? Basic ingredients. This is basic law 101, but I'm going to highlight a few things so that lawyers are kept alerted and don't fall asleep when I cover this. Now, what is agreement? Agreement is what? Normally, agreement is split into offer and acceptance. Always? Not necessarily. If you've got a document in front of you and both parties sign it, you don't need to split the word agreement into offer and acceptance. There you go. You got agreement. That's the first ingredient. Done. Consideration. I'll talk about consideration in a minute. Of course, there must be intention. Warning. If you are in a commercial relationship, like a client and a contractor, contractor, subcontractor, subcontractor, supplier, remember, if you undertake something, the assumption is that you do intend to enter into a legally binding contract. But in a domestic situation, for instance, I might have promised my daughter, hey, Nadia, if you do my PowerPoint slides for me, you know, I'll buy you an ice cream, for instance. Normally, that wouldn't create a legally binding contract. So the intention depends on circumstances, capacity, age, sanity, and so on. If you're mad, obviously it won't. And certainty of terms and so on. I want to deal with consideration very briefly, because now here comes some concepts in law which we need to know. And it's not difficult, but here you go. Let's share it. There must be some exchange of value. If there isn't, then there is no contract. There's no consideration. There's no contract under most circumstances. There are exceptions. We'll talk about the norm first. So there must be some exchange of value. For instance, if I undertake to build the KLCC, for ringgit or $100,000, that's all good. As long as I've undertaken to build, the client is happy, I'm happy, $100,000 is fine. Building the tallest twin towers in the world, no worries, no problem. In other words, there must be consideration. Consideration must be sufficient, but it need not be adequate. So that's a key point. So in other words, sufficiency means there must be some value, but it doesn't have to be a fair value. Okay, so that's a legal principle that we just need to accept it. Okay, this is in typically within the common law jurisdictions. Now, examples of consideration: $1, fine. 1 cent, fine. 1 apple, half an apple. 1 hour, a phone, gold nugget, or anything. So any of these things can be good consideration. It doesn't have to be commensurate. You can build an entire 40-story office block for a mere $1. I mean, I'm exaggerating, but the principle is there. We must all know it. End of story. Simple. Right. Even toilet paper can be good consideration. Well, I've got one here. Can you see it? There you go. Now, this one might not be good consideration because it's opened. Okay? Whereas the one that you see in the picture here, good. There's evidence that it's unopened. Brilliant. Now, so that's consideration. So consideration, you must have some consideration, but it doesn't have to be commensurate. The other that I want to touch on is this. Now, the reason why I want to touch on this is because I know that there are a number of lawyers in the audience, and I would be guided by the lawyers to guide me if I've got this wrong, okay? But this is my understanding. We already said agreement is one of the ingredients, right? One of the ingredients to a legally binding contract. So, agreement is one of the ingredients to a legally binding contract. So, why then do we call it a sale and purchase agreement? Hang on, did I say sale and purchase agreement? But isn't that what lawyers call it all the time? Sale and purchase agreement. So is that not a contract? Is that only one of the ingredients of a contract? Oh, no, 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 no. It's a legally binding contract. Then why do you call it agreement when agreement is one of the several ingredients? It's a bit like my daughter Nadia's brownies ingredients. Flour, butter, brown sugar, baking powder. I don't know. I don't bake, but this is what my daughter says. And of course, her favorite, Whittaker's chocolate from New Zealand, is a favorite. And that's a secret to the reason why everyone seems to like the brownies. These are the ingredients. You don't call flour brownie. Don't use them interchangeably. For instance, this is one of the ingredients to Nadia's brownies. Don't call this a brownie. No, this is one of the ingredients. So don't call a contract agreement or consideration or intention. Those are ingredients. So call a contract contract. Question. If I were to do a poll now, I'm not going to do a poll now, but I asked this question of lawyers in the audience especially. Do you think your SPA, as you call it, sale and purchase agreement, should in future be called sale and purchase contracts? Or should you continue to call them sale and purchase agreements? One word, two different contexts. I know when you say sale and purchase agreement, you mean contract, but why don't you just call it a contract? Anyway, let's move on. Terms of a contract now. What are the terms of a contract? Whatever contract it is, an oral contract, written contract, a construction contract, any contract. Terms can be split into conditions, warranties, enormities. But I'll just focus on the two. Conditions are fundamental terms going to the root of the contract. And warranties are the minor terms. Terms which say, oh, the contractors must provide McDonald's at site meetings or KFC at site meetings. So that's a mere warranty. If there is a breach, you can't terminate the contract, but you can get damages, the cost of McDonald's or KFC or whatever. Whereas conditions are fundamental terms going to the root of the contract. If you breach it, you can terminate the contract and you can get damages. So that's the difference. My question now, coming to construction contracts. Are all terms of contracts in a standard construction contract conditions as defined in law? I'll recap. In any contract, there are conditions, fundamental terms, there are mere warranties, and there are enormity terms. In construction contracts, are all the terms of a construction contract conditions as defined in law? Meaning, any of those breach of conditions, you can terminate and you can recover damages. Answer? I suspect the answer is no, if I were to do a poll now. Every time I do a live audience, everybody says, oh, of course not. You know, not all the terms of a contract, although they're called conditions of contract, not all of them entitle you to terminate the contract. And yet, what are they called? conditions of contract. So why are they called conditions of contract? Is it because of bad habit? Or is it they're careless? I don't care. I'm going to call it conditions. But they are not all conditions as defined in law. They are, well, they might be fundamental terms called conditions. They might be minor terms called warranties. Or they might be innominate terms. But I'm just going to call them conditions. But they are not conditions as defined in law. Why do we do that? Or is it because of negligence, not understanding the difference between the two? Surely not. All lawyers will know the difference between a fundamental term condition and a minor term warranty and innominate terms. Or is it just a blatant breach of the golden rule of drafting? Use one word consistently to mean one thing throughout the contract. I don't know. Question to be asked at some point. Now, how about in future now, instead of calling it a COC, let's call it TOC. Terms of contract, because terms covers everything, conditions, warranties, and so on. Question, how do standard forms of contracts around the world call them? JCT, GC Works 1, the government contract in the UK, FIDIC, PAM in Malaysia, Institute of Engineers in Malaysia, CIDB 2000, and contract in Malaysia, Public Works Department, JBCC in South Africa, CPWD in India, SIA in Singapore, AS 4000 in Australia, and the two in from New Zealand, NZS 391, or NEC 4, which is a plain language contract. Model Terms of Construction Contract 2007 and STCC-RSP. Now, most of these contracts call them conditions of contract, when in law, those words in the contracts itself are not all conditions as defined in law. There are two exceptions, the MTCC 2007 and the STCC-RSP 2015, both of which you can download free. I'll give you the links at some point. Okay. So both of them call them terms of contract, not conditions of contract. Okay, if you look at radio advertisements, what did they say? Oh, terms and conditions apply. Now, let's have a look at that. Terms and conditions. Terms of a contract could be conditions, warranties, innominate terms. And yet, why did they say terms and conditions apply? Don't warranties apply? Well, they do as well. So, why do they call it terms and conditions? In fact, it goes further. They call it T's and C's. Why can't they just say terms apply? Now, if from today onwards, every time you go and listen to the radio and advertisement, and my children do this all the time, I mean, even when they were very young, because I've been drilling into them in the car when we're driving, and they say, Papa, look, did you hear that? I said, well, I think Air Asia calls it terms apply. There are a number of other advertisements as well, where probably the lawyer knows what it is and they've advised the client well, and they say terms apply. So the next time you listen to the radio and an advertisement, listen, do they say terms and conditions apply, or do they say T's and C's apply, or do they say terms apply? Hands up to those who say terms apply. Brilliant. Go and check out the lawyers. They know what they're doing. Now, today is May 4th, and I know in Malaysia, people have been waiting for May the 4th, because this is, by the way, the Nur Hisham Abdullah, he's the person in charge of the health authority in Malaysia, and he's been coming every day on the news. And today in Malaysia, well,
it's 7:30.
You do have some more freedom to a limited extent. And what has also happened, apparently he has managed to bend the curve, if you want. So he has managed to beat the coronavirus, well, to a certain extent. So, and today is a day that lots of Malaysians are celebrating and so on. But remember, we're still in a situation where we must be very careful. This is a situation in New Zealand now. Okay, the daily cases is going down. And guess what? Today, May the 4th, Ashley Bloomfield, the equivalent in New Zealand, has declared no new cases for the first time for more than a month. So, brilliant. Now, I also want to share this with you. And the reason is because the judges have heard a case where someone wanted to visit during a lockdown period. And the judge has said, no, the government cannot stop them from going to visit. And that was today, the news came out. And then I thought to myself, wow, you know, so even the government, who is doing a good job, can be overruled by judges. Fair enough. And today as well, I got an offer from Vodafone, my phone service provider. And they give me a $15 discount. Wow, for the good of price. And then I saw that T and C's apply. Look at that. T and C's apply. As if I read all the terms and conditions. Anyway, I didn't bother. Vodafone, your lawyers need to change that to terms apply. Anyway, let's move on. Now, before we actually create a contract, there's this tender document that contractor normally puts in. What constitutes the tender document? The various documents that you submit. Now, when it comes to a contract document, however, you're basically locking the parties into a legally binding contract. Now, the question is, why is there a big gap between when you submit the tender and the client is decided to award your contract and actually preparing the contract document? There often is a big gap. There is no reason why the gap should be maintained for many, many days or weeks. I'll talk about that shortly. Before that, let's say you haven't firmed up a contract. You may well want to issue what's called a letter of intent. Some call it letter of comfort. I noticed that when it comes to consultants, they call it letter of comfort, but when it comes to mucky boot contractors, they call it letter of intent. Now, why do we have letters of intent? Letters of intent, on the face of it, normally do not create a legally binding contract. Of course, it depends on the wording and the term, what it is that the circumstances are, but normally they don't create a legally binding contract. They're a mere expression of intention to enter into a contract in the future. Now, that being the case, why have a letter of intent? Can they be dispensed with? Can we do without letters of intent? What is an alternative? Now, here's a thought. If really you want to give a letter of intent, for what? So that the share prices of the contractor who is listed in the stock exchange goes up? Hey, I've got a letter of intent. I'm getting this huge $400 million project or whatever, and your share price go up. But letter of intent might not create legally binding contract. What's the point? So if really, the reason the letter of intent is critically important is because, hey, look, you want the contractor to do some work. Here is my suggestion as an alternative to the letter of intent, which may or may not create legally binding contract. Remember, we don't want ambiguity. The way the letter of intent is worded can create legally binding contract, but normally it doesn't. We don't want all that. We want certainty. So the alternative is this. If you've got some earthwork to be done and just the earthwork to be done, issue a small contract, a preliminary contract if you want, on the basis of that particular scope of works, say substructure. There you go. You've got a substructure work to be done and that's the limited scope. You have a legally binding contract and it's worth so much. No letter of intent. Avoid it if at all you can. Then we move on to this creature called letter of award or letter of acceptance. Different people, same thing. People use the same thing. Next question. Why do you have these things called letter of award, letter of acceptance? Remember, right in the beginning I said, there must be agreement, consideration, intention, capacity, and so on. There must be agreement. Now, if the tender is an offer by the contractor, which the client can accept creating a legally binding contract, sure. But my point here is, do you always need a letter of acceptance to conclude that deal? Why not the contract document itself? Remember, we're talking about tender documents and contract documents. Why can't the contract documents themselves be all ready and prepared and be bound and just sign the contract itself? Why do you need this thing called letter of award, letter of acceptance? Oh, Naseem, it's because the documents are not ready. The contract document hasn't been bound and so on. Oh dear, why not? Oh, we're sending it to the printers and it's taking 3 months for the printers to print the drawings. Surely you could have printed all the drawings earlier and get it all ready. And over a matter of a week or so, you could have got it all ready and that's the document is signed. End of story. You don't need letter of acceptance or letter of award. Okay, someone says, I need a letter of acceptance or whatever so that I can buy the insurance in advance. Maybe for that reason. But when you actually get into actual legally binding contract, you can dispense with letter of award. Okay, now let's move on. What is plain language? What do we mean by that? The answer is, if you ask a lawyer, they are always saying, this could be a cat, this could be a series of triangles and a square and a trapezium or whatever it is. So lawyers are not the best persons to answer this question because they will say, what do you want it to be? Because they can act on either side. the adversarial system, that is. This too might be very confusing, but lawyers can make it out to be whatever it is, and you can argue either way and say this is a dog, this is a monkey, this is a squirrel, and so on. Now, when we talk about what is plain language, I would suggest plain language is language that when you read a particular document, plain legal language, that is, when you read a particular contract, for instance, you can understand it on first reading, and I'll be kind to say on second reading. I know there are many world authorities on monolegal drafting who expect plain language to be defined as understood on first reading, but I'll be a bit more forgiving. Maybe I need to read it the second time. Maybe English might not be my first language and so on. So give it a chance. Read it the second time. And if you still don't understand it, that is not plain language. Okay? Now, understood by whom? A motivated reader. Example, in a construction contract, is the client a motivated reader? Of course, they're entering into the contract. They're going to be signing it. They don't want to sign a blank check. Is a contractor a motivated reader? Absolutely. Subcontractor, yes. Supplier, yes. Engineer, yes. Architect, quantity surveyor, specialists, contractors. Yep, we are all motivated readers. So, I repeat, we must be able to understand the document on first reading, ideally, if not, second reading. If you or I or any of these motivated people cannot understand, then it's not our fault, it is a drafter's fault. The drafting needs to be rectified. Now, I've showed you several examples of plain language drafting guidelines from all over the world. Now, this is my standard. As long as you can comply with any of these standards around the world, I'm happy. Doesn't have to be what I construe it to be a plain language. Okay, doesn't have to be my definition, can be any of those. And against any of those standards, you can test standard forms of construction contracts against these guidelines. Okay, you can ask those questions yourself. Once I've finished this, you can answer it yourself. PAM, JKR, JCT, 391, FIDIC, AIAC, CPWD, JBCC, or whatever. Do they or do they not comply with any of those plain legal drafting guidelines? Yes or no? You will be able to answer the question yourself once I've given you the guidelines. Now, here are the 17 or so that I've picked out. Now, all these 17 or so guidelines that I've got are consistent with any plain legal language drafting guideline in the world, including the ones that I've listed earlier. I repeat, these are extracted. These are non-controversial common drafting guidelines, okay? And they are, I'll run through them one by one shortly. But anyway, here are 9 of them. And here are another 8. Okay, and there's 17 of them. Now, I want to highlight something. At the bottom of the page, there is a reference when you get the slides and so on to a paper that I wrote in 2008. That's 12 years ago, published by the Society of Construction Law UK, which... that's a long time ago. What I'm saying, sharing with you today is not new. Look, you can just download it and read it for yourself, okay? Now, let's look at these one by one. Average words per sentence of around 20. Judge Mark Painter in his 40 Rules of Legal Drafting suggests 18. Well, why 18? Anyway, he thinks it should be about 18. I would say about 20. Look, 18, 20, no big difference. Remember, average words per sentence, not necessarily every sentence has to be 20 or 18, okay? Average. So some could be 30, some could be 5, some could be 8, and so on. By the way, American president speeches these days average around about 15 or so. That's how powerful they are. Gender-neutral language, of course, you know, don't say he, and that includes she and it and everything else. Don't do that. Use gender-neutral language without using the cumbersome he or she or he or whatever. Active sentences are better. The contractor must submit the program is better than passive. The program must be submitted by the contractor. There you go. 3 examples there. Plain words are better than complex words. Let me give you an example. The word determination. What does it mean? Determination? I'm determined to finish this by 8 o'clock New Zealand time or 4 o'clock Malaysia time or 9 o'clock UK time because you've got to go to work. No, you don't. You're still in lockdown. But anyway, I'm determined. That's one meaning. Second, If you don't behave, Mr. Contractor, I'm going to determine your contract. Wow, that's a second meaning. A third meaning, the adjudicator is going to make a determination as to who is right and who is wrong and how much you're supposed to pay. Three meanings of the word determination. Bad drafting. Don't use the word determination unless you use it consistently to mean only one thing in a particular document. Otherwise, shun the word determination because it's got three meanings. There you go. So plain word without that would be better. Prefer words with fewer syllables. This is my favorite. How not to. I am going to utilize my phone to make a call. What should I say? I'm going to use my phone. I'm going to utilize my pen to write my report. Come on, get out of here. Fewer syllables is better. Just say use. I'm going to use my pen. I'm going to use the toilet paper. Not I'm going to utilize my toilet paper. Please, the next time you see anyone using the word utilize, tell them they're not even showing off. They're being downright silly. Anyway, because cumulatively, the document that becomes long and convoluted doesn't help the reader, doesn't help the lay people like me, you, and the normal people. Redundant doublets. So null and void is a good example. You don't need null and void. Okay. Fit and proper, goods and chattel, save and accept, each and every, null, void, and of no effect, give, device, and duplicate. These are all redundant doublets and triplets. Oh, who am I to say that? Oh, word of warning, I'm not a lawyer. Okay. Now, this comes from pretty much every modern legal drafting guideline in the world. So, not just me saying it, the world authorities are saying it. Okay. Let's move on. 7, 8, 9. Avoid the redundant use of the repeat of words in number. Have you come across this annoying? This is one of my most annoying drafting stuff. You must submit your notice within 14 bracket F-O-U-R-T-E-E-N. You must submit your notice within 16 bracket S-I-X-T-E-E-N. Oh, not necessary. All modern legal drafting principles say don't use it. And of course, words like whereas, here and before, here and after, said, the said, and so on. Don't use that. Use paragraphs and listing, which is good practice. And just to share with you some examples of this, right? These are all not legal terms of art. Whereas, here and before, there and after, said, and stroke, or the said, subject always, has caused the drawings to an ever pernicious shell. They're not. Okay? Now let's continue. Multiple cross-referencing, subject always to this, that, and the other. Nope, that's bad drafting. A sensible logical structure. In a construction contract, here is a logical structure. Collect all the clauses relating to time together. Commencement, progress, program, extension of time, completion on completion. Put all the money clauses together, perhaps the bond, insurance, payment, retention, final accounts, and put all the quality clauses together, for instance. That's a logical structure. Why can't all construction contracts in the world be rearranged so that the all clauses have got some sort of a logical structure? Look at your own contract that you're using right now, and you tell me whether there is a logical structure, yes or no. An excessive unnecessary definition is also not necessary. Of course, having said all that, you must preserve legal terms of art. Research in the US shows that fewer than 3% of the wordings of a conveyancing contract are legal terms of art. My own research shows fewer than 1%. And I'll show you a few examples in a minute. Practical completion, that's a term of art. Liquidated damage, that's a term of art. Reasonable skill and care, yes. Fitness purpose, yes. What else? Oh, I'm trying to think now. Progressing with the work regularly and diligently. Yes, that's a term of art. It's been legally defined. I'm struggling now. In a 20,000 word document contract, I'm struggling to even get 10. And avoid using words that have got multiple meanings. I give example of determination. Avoid Latin phrases. Judge Mark Painter says that Latin is a dead language and it should remain buried. Don't use things like end stroke or, and of course, adopt the golden rule. What's the golden rule? Never change your language unless you wish to change your meaning, and always change your language if you wish to change your meaning. Okay, here are some examples of legal terms of art. Reasonable skill and care, practical. Oh, I actually gave those examples earlier. So there you go. And these are not terms of art. You don't have to call them lessor and lessee. Huh? Buyer and seller is good enough. Buyer and seller is good. You don't have to call them vendor and what? Vendee? Payer and payee? Well, maybe. Yeah, that's not too bad and so on. Now, I'm going to give some examples of contracts that are commonly used. Okay, here is an example. And I understand today there are quite a fair number of people from New Zealand as well. So there you go. Principal shall be entitled. Doesn't that mean may? So use the word may because that's what it means. What's wrong with shall? I'll talk about what's wrong with shall in a minute. And here again, principal shall be entitled to. It means may. It's good. Or shall continue means continues. Drop the shall. Shall be entitled. May again. Must means must. But shall can have at least 7 or 8 meanings according to who? Wow. This guy, Brian Garner, writes dictionaries on modern legal usage. Not me. This is Brian Garner. So I'm just quoting Brian Garner. Don't use shall. That's it. Okay. If you look at parliamentary acts of parliament in countries like New Zealand, New South Wales, and Victoria, and Queensland certainly, and the new Hong Kong drafting guideline, no more shall. There has not been any shall in legislation in New Zealand for the past 10 years, maybe 20 years. Okay. And here's a list of the multiple meanings of shall, according to Professor Peter Butt. Who is Professor Peter Butt? He's an emeritus professor from Sydney Law School. So respect him. Very nice, very humble chap. Hundreds of shall in most of these contracts. I'm not saying it's wrong to use shall, but the problem is shall can mean must, may, and so many other things. So avoid it. And here is another example of the use of the shall in one clause, in 111 words, meaning 3 different things. This breaches the golden rule of drafting. This comes from the Public Works Department contract in Malaysia. This has to stop by 2030. I'm giving them 10 years. Again, convoluted drafting. I don't want to go into details of it. It's there. It's a mess. When? All they needed to do when it says, you know, this contract deemed to be a Malaysian contract shall accordingly be construed against the law for the time being in force. Courts have excluded to hear and determine action proceedings and all that. Forget all that. All it says is Malaysian law applies to this contract or this contract is governed by Malaysian law. Okay. So contracts can be rewritten in plain language. This is another example. This is a favorite, a favorite of how not to draft. This comes from the JCT, the design and build supplement, as well as the JCT design and build contract, current one. Okay, 100 words in one sentence, insofar as the contract is responsible for the design, blah, 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 blah. Now, the question is this, how are we going to learn principles of construction contracts if this is what I'm supposed to be dealing with over the next 5 days? I'm sorry, I give up. Can't be done, not within 5 days. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a plain language contract which would use words like this. The contractor owes a reasonable skill and care obligation. Now, let me explain to you what reasonable skill and care means. Let me explain to you what fitness for purpose means and so on. I can concentrate on the legal principles instead of, what do we do with this? I mean, where do I start? Bad drafting. That's not the way. So if you want to pick up the legal principles, use a plain language contract. That is why I will be using the plain language contract called STCC, which you can download prior to this, maybe before tomorrow's session, and then we can run through it. I'll be running through. There are only 7 clauses, and I'm quite confident we'll be able to get through that over the next remaining 4 days. Having said that, the contractor owes a reasonable care obligation for design is okay, but don't overdo it. The contractor must be careful when designing doesn't mean the same thing as you must exercise reasonable skill and care. Okay, so don't overdo it because you lose the legal meaning. So I'm not saying you overdo it to that extent. I mentioned about Latin and what Judge Painter had to say about that. This comes from the this is the old ancestral rule, not the latest one, but still it had words like amiable, compositor, ex aequat bono. I've asked lawyers this. Do you know what it means? They sort of know, but they can't quite remember. Anyway, Judge Painter says, Latin is a dead language and it should remain buried. So there you go. That's his view, not mine. Again, his legal writer is a brilliant, very easily readable book? Legalese, basically, is a bit like dinosaurs. And where does it belong? Answer? In museums, yeah. I've just added that. The reason is because, do you know that in 2008, 12 years ago, Judge Painter, Professor Peter Budd, Dr. Robert Eagleson from Victoria, who was instrumental in law reform, he's passed away since, and myself and Tan Sui Im, a well-known construction lawyer who was in our series of talks, we presented at this international conference on non-legal drafting for construction. And when we asked the audience, do you prefer plain language or traditional? Every hand went up. And the reason why I put this in is because you'll have it in your notes or your slides later on, click on it and see what Judge Painter had to say about his experience for the first time ever getting out of America to Malaysia. He thoroughly enjoyed it and he was quite fascinated with lots of things. And remember, that was organized 12 years ago and here we are. I'm trying to talk to you about plain legal drafting, and the AIAC contract is not in plain language. The PAM contract is not in plain language. The JKR contract is not in plain language. The NZS 3910 in New Zealand is much better, could be better. And the JVCC is not. The Hong Kong contract is not. The JCT is far, far from it. Anyway, I plan to write a white paper, and by the end of this year, hopefully we can travel, maybe have another international conference. This time, launch the white paper with a target by 2030, all construction contracts in the world will be in plain language. And here you go. Lots of convoluted examples. The reason why I highlighted this is the annoying use of supervision overhead profits and or other costs and or in connection and or arising from contract. This is a brilliant example of how not to draft. Because NOR has been criticized by judges as being an abominable invention, inexcusable barbarism, and Janus face verbal monstrosity. These are harsh words. And the ultimate that really got me woken up in the late 90s, early 2000s. The child of the brain of someone too lazy or too dull to express his precise meaning or too dull to know what he did mean. In other words, instead of calling it dull, basically saying, I was stupid when I was using words like or things like and stroke or. Even English judges have referred to it as, I don't swear, but the judge said it was bastardly style. So anyway, to ban these things. And this is the email that I got in 2004 from Judge Mark Painter. 2004, they banned the use of and stroke or and other whereas and other legalism. And here we are, 16 years on, and I'm appealing to you, to the 453 people who are online now, assuming you're still listening to me, to say, please, it's time to wake up, put a stop to all this nonsense. Here is an example of what you can do, an alternative to and stroke or. So instead of saying A and or B and or C, just say a combination of one or more of the following. So there are alternative ways to draft without using and stroke or. And there is more and more. Okay, that's it. Yeah, there's plenty more, but I don't want to waste my time. I think let's move on. So who uses a contract? Client, contract, subcontractor, suppliers, contract administrator, the engineer, the architect, the QS, and so on. Who are the secondary users? Lawyers, judges, arbitrators, adjudicators, mediators, and so on. Who should be written for? For everybody. Now, what do you do? How do you kick the habit of legalese? The answer is you just have to learn how, like learning a new language called Spanish or Mandarin. My daughter is in Taiwan now for a year, picking up Chinese. So I hope when she comes back, she can speak fluent Chinese, but I'll be struggling to pick up Spanish, just like many, many lawyers struggle to pick up this new language called plain language or plain English because they write in legalese. Here's another example from a contract, you know, which shows how you can do a before and after. This was actually done by one of my students, master students. I mentioned about the logical structure as well. I mentioned about the logical structure. Here is an example of a logical structure. Put all the time clauses together, financial clauses, quality clauses, subcontracting clauses, and all that. So, and then towards the end, you have a termination and dispute resolution clause. Why can't you do that? This is the vision that I want to emphasize and persuade you towards. And that is, all construction contracts in the world are written in modern plain language by when? By 2030. This is my vision, and I hope you share that vision with me. Now, to demonstrate that this is just not theory, there is a standard form of contract already published, which was published in 2015 by the Construction Industry Development Board Malaysia, and it was endorsed by the architects, the engineers, the Royal Institution of Surveyors Malaysia, the Master Builders Insurance, and the Public Works Department in Malaysia, and they've endorsed it. There's a link to it. Now, the organizers, I'll make sure that they send you the link to download this contract. Please download the contract before tomorrow's session, because I will be using this contract. Of course, I will show it on the slides and screen as well. But it'll be nice if you have a copy of yourself. Okay, it is the first construction contract in the world to have got that clear English standard accreditation by the Plain Language Commission UK. And this is an example extract of the contents page, which I will be going through clause by clause relating to. So I'll be looking at time clause tomorrow. When we talk about time concepts, I'll be looking at the clause from this contract and some examples of how not to draft. Financial on Wednesday, and quality subcontract termination on Thursday, and then a dispute resolution on Friday, and so on. So you can see that logical structure. And here's just a simple extract compared to what clauses we have been looking at. The contract administrator must do this or whatever. Okay? All contract administrators' instructions must be in dated and made in writing. You know, this is the style. The contractor must start the work on the date stated in A6, and so on. Okay? This is the pro forma I mentioned. As I said, tomorrow onwards, when we deal with the time provision, I'll be looking at the template on practical completion. And we'll look at it. So if it's on a Microsoft Word document, you can fill it, but you can see the style, the certified practical completion, which is achieved on whatever. Okay. So you'll book in all those templates. So the templates are already there. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. It's all there. The features of the STCC-RSP are plain language, structure is good, no whereas, no shall, no end stroke or, no redundant doublets like null and void, no Latin phrases, no multiple cross-referencing. It's about 19.19 words per sentence. The passive sentences are a bit more than 25%, not brilliant, but it could be better. Judge Painter suggests about 18%. It's about 5,000 words, sorry, not 50,000 words. So it's complex, but on the face of it, is simple. These are what some authorities have said about the contract, and these are, I would classify that as amongst the top 10 world authorities. Joseph Kimball redrafted the court procedures. He said, looks pretty good. Okay, Peter Butt, famous Peter Butt, emeritus professor, says a marvelous document. I'm talking about the drafting style. They referred to the model terms of subcontract 2007, but very similar style. And Judge Painter says, looks good. Seems all plain language principles were followed. Especially good is the must instead of the ever pernicious shall. Okay. Mark Adler, from whose book published by the Law Society in the UK, says clearly and attractively laid out short sentences. You've done a good job. Okay. So again, the Society of Construction Law paper is there. You can download it yourself. I just want to briefly mention this, that there is now a quantity surveying consultancy services contract published by the New Zealand Institute of Quantity Surveyors, which has also got accreditation from the Plain Language Commission UK. So there's a link to it there. I'm not sure if Marilyn will allow you to access it if you're not a member of NZIQS, but surely, you know, you can write to her and so on, ask permission. And this is how it looks like. And my vision is by 2030, all consultancy contracts are also written in plain language, not just quantity surveying consultancy contract, but others, you know, multidisciplinary ones for engineers and so on. And I want to finish off the last few slides by appealing to professionals. And this, in this, a definition of professional is client's interest before self-interest. When you draft contracts in plain language, you're putting the client's interest before your self-interest. And that is a sign of altruism, which is a prerequisite to the definition of professionals. So remember that. Writing contracts in language that primarily suits the parties reflects altruism and more. Christopher Barnford in Australia said, today commercial clients are prepared to pay for legal services, but one day clients everywhere will refuse to pay for legal services unless they are plain. So heed that advice. And he said that in 2002, that's nearly 20 years ago. I end this now with this vision for the future. And that is a future within over the next 10 years, by 2030, where every construction contract, remember, I'll talk about smart contracts on Friday, smart or otherwise, has got a structure and plain language style that parties to the contract administrator, and secondary users like dispute resolver can understand clearly and easily. Not necessarily on first reading, maybe at least on second reading. I'm now preparing a white paper. When it is ready, I will share it with worldwide. In fact, all of you who are here will be welcome to critique it and so on. And I hope that you will come back tomorrow. Tomorrow, we'll be talking about, let me just see what time it is. Oh, yep, it's spot on 8 o'clock, which is 4 o'clock Malaysia time and 9 o'clock London time. Tomorrow, I will be talking about the various principles relating to time obligations. And you will see that, okay, there you go. You're viewing the tech moderator screen. And that's it. Exactly 1 hour, a project completed on time. I just want to say a few more things before we go off. And that is this. Two things. One is, I'm going to activate a poll shortly, or rather the tech moderator will activate a poll. Might be one or two polls. So just do a quick reply. You just give the answer, whatever your answer is. That's the first thing. The second thing is, if you've got any questions at all, put it in the chat function. The tech moderator will be printing out the whole, all the questions and all your comments and so on. And he will be collating it. And tomorrow, well, you're giving it to me shortly. And then by tomorrow, I will have read it all. And tech moderator, you can, if you have a second poll, you can ask the second poll as well. If not, if everyone has a few, maybe a few hundred people have responded, you can close the first poll and activate the second poll. And at some point, you can actually share the poll results as well. It's all anonymous anyway. So all your questions, feel free to ask on the chat function. You can this will keep on going on. The DJ will, Daniel will be putting on some music for you. You can stay and have a chat and maybe, you know, start waving to each other if you've got your screens on and so on, because you can all turn on your video. I'll be around as well and I'll wave to you and all that. And you can ask all your questions. You'll all be collated. Tomorrow, I'll answer the questions probably before I start with the second day session relating to time issues. We'll be talking about lots of things relating to time, okay? Including some, not controversial, but basic things. Like, why do I call it adjustment of time instead of extension of time and so on. So with that, let's just call it a day. And the tech moderator will shortly be sharing the results of the poll. And at some point, he'll be putting on some music as well. He'll normally put on the music 1 hour before we check in tomorrow. And you can actually get the results of the poll, I think. Let me take a picture of this, the poll result. Wow, okay. Oh, wow, that's amazing. So 97% of however many people responded, the 400 over, prefer a plain language over traditional, and 30%, 29% want it all done by 2030, 47% want it done by 2025, and 25% want it done right now. Thank you all, and we'll see you tomorrow, nice and early.